This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
The debate over voter ID requirements next on Behind the Headlines. I'm Eric Barnes. Thanks for joining us. We're joined today by Van Turner, chairman of the Shelby County Democratic Party. Van, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
And Justin Joy, chairman of the Shelby County Republican Party. Justin, thank you for joining us. Also joined by our journalists today, Bill Dries from the Memphis Daily News and Jackson Baker from the Memphis Flyer. We are here today to talk extensively about the voter ID requirements, requirements that the Tennessee legislature passed in 2010, I believe, and went into effect in January of this year. Let me start here going left to right. Your thoughts on the requirements. They are photo ID requirements, Van. Is that an unreasonable requirement that someone shows an official government ID that matches the person to the voter? Doesn't that make for a sound election?
Well, prior to now, we could use just use our voter cards, the cards that we received when we registered to vote. And I think that was a fine process. It was a less restrictive process than what we have now. And the basis for the photo ID law is voter fraud. And the case in which they point to is Senator Ford's case, which in that instance, the photo ID requirement would not have even addressed what went on in that case. That case dealt with purportedly folks who had passed voting. And there were a number of issues involved in that case which this photo ID law would not address what occurred.
It was ultimately found to be the fraudulent actions of a worker at the Election Commission, correct?
And a photo ID law would not have stopped that. Okay. So essentially, our position is there's no basis for this law. We think that it suppresses the voters. It makes the process more restrictive.
Okay.
It was fine how it was working. There was no huge, significant mass voter fraud taking place in Tennessee.
Right.
And we just don't agree with the law.
Well, let me get Justin in. Justin, it was a Republican-dominated legislature, a Republican governor, I believe, who signed that bill. It's been passed by other Republican legislatures around the country. What was the need that the Republicans saw in passing that bill?
Eric, it's all a matter of building confidence and trust in our voting system. And to go back to your earlier question, it's absolutely reasonable to ask that voters present a photo ID when they go vote. We have to present photo IDs for all types of things that we do in modern life today, whether it's entering a government building, presenting a check for cashing using a check, using a credit card, boarding an airplane. There's all types of activities in life that you have to present a photo ID. And if we ask that those types of things where you have to prove who you are, as important as voting is, I believe it's absolutely reasonable that we ask people, require people, to present evidence of their identification.
Bill, we'll get you in.
So we had the March primaries. Under this new law, we're now into early voting for the August primaries and the county general election. Then, have you had any complaints about people who you feel have been turned away unreasonably because of the law at this point?
Well, we have not as of yet. I'm told that there are some issues, and I'll probably be briefed on those issues today. Unfortunately, the turnout will not be what it will be on August 2nd, which is Election Day. The good part is that, there will probably be several cases and potential plaintiffs which will be affected. The bad part is that people will be disenfranchised. There will be mass chaos and confusion, and folks won't be allowed to vote. So we're hoping and we're asking that folks go and try to vote now during the early voting process, and if there are issues, we can get those resolved and make sure their votes are counted. And if there is an issue which prevents them from voting, we can go ahead and get them lined up and get to court as quickly as we can.
And a question for Justin. Justin, is there some chilling effect? Are there people who might think, well, I don't have the right idea, or I don't think I have the right idea? Is it realistic to assume that there might be some people who would choose to just stay home and not bother with it because of this requirement?
Now, Bill, let's go back to the March election of this year, statewide election. We had almost 650,000 people statewide who voted. And out of those 650,000 people who voted, there was about 300 out of 650,000 votes cast. There was 300 provisional ballots cast because people didn't have photo ID when they showed up to vote.
A provisional ballot, I get confused about what that is. Just a technical issue.
Yeah, a provisional ballot can be cast for a number of reasons. Somebody shows up to the polling place and for whatever reason they're not on that particular precinct's poll book.
Okay.
And in the case now where we have this photo ID requirement, if somebody shows up and they don't have a photo ID to present, then they can ask to cast a provisional ballot. And if the provisional ballot is cast because they don't have a photo ID, then they have 48 hours after the election to go back and present that photo ID.
So the provisional ballot is set aside. It's not counted.
That's right.
And you've got to prove that that is actually a valid person.
Right.
And you should put that in the pile that you're going
right.
to count.
That's right. Thus the term provisional.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
But to go back to looking at what we have, what did happen in Tennessee in March, again, we had about almost 650,000 votes cast. And out of that large universe of votes cast, there were only 300, or actually less than 300, provisional ballots cast because people didn't have photo ID. I mean, when you're talking about numbers like that, we're talking, very few thousands of 1%.
Do you agree with those numbers, Van? I mean, is that your sense? Is that what you all heard from your side of the number of people who had problems?
I haven't had any type of research done on that. But I mean, if one voter is turned away because of a law that's unnecessary, that's one too many.
Right. Let's get Jackson in.
Well, I actually have a question independent of this reaction, but it occurs to me that you're citing a relatively low number of people who asked for provisional ballots, meaning that there weren't that many people inconvenienced. It doesn't address the issue of how many people didn't show up in the first place because they knew they didn't have a photo ID, didn't know about provisional ballots because not everybody knows the complications of voting. But hold on to that thought. I'd like you to address that. But also, when you were talking about how we present photo IDs for this, that, and the other, to ride an airplane, to cash a check at a bank, to use a credit card, et cetera, you're talking about middle-class actions there. And a lot of people, most of the people who don't have photo IDs, I would suggest, are not used to these activities to the same degree as people who belong to the middle class. And there is there not a kind of preferential disqualification of people on that basis? And here's another issue.
Well, let's let him answer that question.
Yeah.
Let's
let him answer that. Absolutely not. I mean, again, there's entering a government building, you have to present a photo ID. Cashing a check, in many cases, you have to present a photo ID. This is not a class thing. It's for all Tennesseans.
But does the one complaint right now, and we'll have Bruce Kramer from the lawyer representing the ACLU coming up later in the show, I should mention, about this very issue, that in Shelby County, the city, I believe, has voted they want to allow photo ID library cards, that those should be allowed as proof. And it to some degree gets to what Jackson's alluding to, the complaints that the only people who have photo ID people with driver's license or passports or things that maybe the poor or the elderly don't have. The photo ID library cards issued by the library system in Memphis won't be allowed. Is that make sense to you?
I don't know all of the arguments that have been raised on that. I'm not going to pretend to be an expert in this area of this issue. But here's what I understand is that the state, the legislature, which has jurisdiction over state election law, obviously, and they have the final say-so, as I understand the law, it's very clear that it's got to be either a federally issued ID or a state-issued ID, and that's it.
I want to follow up on that a little bit because when this issue arose of the library cards here, Mark Goins, the election coordinator, who, by the way, I think does a pretty good job trying to do the right thing, and he said he consulted with the authors of the legislation, one of whom is Deborah Maggard, whom you know, and she said basically, as she had said at the time the bill was passed, that cities, that there tended to be more fraud in issuing licenses in cities than state licenses and federal licenses. That's why they're not allowed in the bill. That, now, when you think of cities, what are cities? They're places of huge Democratic pockets. Memphis, certainly. Nashville, to some degree. Even Knoxville in East Tennessee has a lot of Democrats voting. If cities are if city licenses are disqualified, is this not yet another way of slanting the outcome? I'm wondering.
No, it's not. This is not a Republican issue or a Democrat issue. This is an issue that affects all Tennesseans. And again, it goes back to building confidence in our voting system to make sure that when somebody shows up to the polling place to vote, that they are who they say that they are. And it's really as simple as that.
Van, do you see it? I mean, in other states, I'm sure in Tennessee too, but you know, people have said that this is a voter suppression activity, ALEC, which is a conservative think tank, was the source for a lot of the model legislation that's been passed around the country, including Tennessee's, and that it's just an effort to get, as Jackson was alluding to, historically Democratic voters to make it more difficult for them to vote. Is that how you see it?
Yeah, I mean, clearly that's the intended purpose. When you look at the Library ID initiative, there are approximately 20 to 21 libraries situated all throughout the county. You have about five driver licensing bureaus that are here in the city where you can get these driver licenses and state-issued ID. So 20 compared to five, I think we can do the math. And if we could add the two of them, that would be even a better scenario where you would have more locations and more access to getting the library cards in order to comply with the state ID law. And when we drill down on that issue, it says state-issued ID. The city of Memphis is a division of the state of Tennessee. Part of the division of the city of Memphis is the library system. A photo identification issued by a library, which is part of the city, which the city is part of the state, is a state-issued ID when you look at the black and white letter of the law. I mean, that's what they're
again,
doing.
We'll get to that. It's a fair point, and we'll get to that with Bruce Kramer from the ACLU. They are gearing up probably to file suit. There have been suits filed all over the country to that effect. Bill, question from you.
I sensed a response from you. You are listening particularly intently on that point. What would be wrong with a photo library card ID if security concerns could be satisfied, or could they be for this kind of identification?
Well, again, as I understand the state law, and again, obviously the state has jurisdiction over voting laws, that it has to be a photo identification issued by a state agency or a federal agency. And if the state has said that the law means what it says and it's only from a state agency, then that's got to be that.
But that also includes an expired driver's license. The basic aim here, as Mark Goins has explained it, is that we're not really interested if your driver's license is current. We're interested in something that shows that you are who you say you are.
But the driver's license is issued by the state of Tennessee.
Not necessarily. You can have one from Kentucky, as I understand it, or Massachusetts, anywhere.
Right.
Expired, even.
I guess the part of the question would be, you know, if, let's say, in the future legislatures, that a proposal came forward to expand the net. Let's say the Democrats, you know, people try to work together and say, you know, well, let's expand it to include photo ID libraries and so on. Do you think the Republican Party would be, at least the folks you're in touch with from Shelby County, would be in favor of that?
I haven't heard any proposals along those lines.
Fair enough. Let's move on a little bit. We've got a couple minutes left with you all before we get Bruce Kramer here and talk about generally an issue we talked before the show that there's a lot of agreement between Republicans and Democrats, and that's the problems with the election process so far this year. Bill, maybe you could summarize real quickly some of the problems that people have run into, and then we'll get your guys a chance to give some feedback on that.
Well, we started having a lot of complaints the day that early voting really expanded to the satellite sites, which was this past Monday. We're about a week into the early voting period, and it falls along the lines of voters who are entitled to vote on the municipal schools referendum not being able to vote on it, some problems with people who have looked up on state maps and they're in a legislative district, but another map is showing they're in another one. Give me an idea of kind of the range of complaints that each one of you had heard. Justin, what have you heard from your side?
I have heard that there's been some problems, some difficulties in voters in the municipalities going to vote and the referendum ballot isn't appearing on their ballot face. But let me say something real quick. There's no such thing as a perfect election. They're run by human beings and things are going to happen. I do think that the Shelby County Election Commission works very hard and does a very good job in making sure that we've got the best election that we absolutely can. And we have just gone through a year, the past year or two, where you've had lines that have been redrawn at all levels, the federal level, congressional district lines, at the state level, both state House and state Senate lines have been redrawn. And then here locally, lines have also been redrawn, even with the municipalities. So the Election Commission, like I said, I think does a very good job in inputting all that data into the machines and doing the very best that they can to make sure that when you go vote, your ballot, which, by the way, depending on where you live in the county, like we're talking about, you know, particular municipalities or outside of those municipalities, it's going to be different. So they have to get all this data together, put it into the machines, and make sure that you're getting your right ballot face.
Van, what have you been hearing from folks?
Same thing. There was one issue where a guy lived in state representative seat 93, and what appeared on the face of his ballot was 98. He did the right thing. He stopped and said, I'm not going to cast his vote. I'm going to get some help. He got some help, came back, they corrected it, and he was able to vote for his correct state representative in that district. You know, I think that we've seen some issues in the past. We had hoped that they were corrected. I do understand the point that a lot has changed. The lines have changed statewide, federal-wise and locally. We have a new school board, unified school board. Those are new lines, but still, you know, there's, you know, been some, accusation of the nonchalant attitude of some of the persons with the Election Commission, and they're not taking it seriously. And there may be an issue of, you know, well, I'm happy that we are seeing these now because, you know, thankfully, it's not on election
right.
day, where it
right.
is voting time. The votes that you count, the votes that are cast during early voting are votes that are actual votes. And you know, we need to address the issues as soon as we can.
And I should note that we requested the members of the Election Commission to come on this week. They weren't able to. They were busy, obviously. Maybe we'll be able to have them on in the future. Last question from you, Jackson.
Yeah, and I seem to be addressing all my questions to you, and that's probably because you were sitting to my right and you're close by. But I want to absolve you of something because basically you're having to answer for something that Republican legislators did. You had nothing to do with that. And you have nothing to do with the Election Commission either. But there seem to have been an unusual number of glitches since the Republicans took over administration of the Election Commission locally. There was that big glitch in August 2010. There was that glitch earlier this year, the so-called erased histories, which turned out not to be really erased histories. And now there's this. There's something different every day as this early voting period continues. Is that an accident, or is there something, some reason why this Republican administration is getting into so many of those things?
Well, I'm not sure if we've had more or less glitches, as you're referencing, Jackson, since the Republicans have come along. But again, it gets back to there's no such thing as a perfect election. But whether you're talking about voter ID, all the efforts that a local election commission makes here to make sure that we've got a good election, you know, I think they do a very good job, and they make sure that we've got the best election that we can.
All right, we will leave it there. I want to thank you. Thank you, Justin Joy, for being here. Van Turner, thank you for being here. We move on now to a conversation with Bruce Kramer, representing the ACLU, in a lawsuit likely to be filed soon, challenging the inability to use the library cards that we were just talking about. That comes, again, from the state law that was passed, went into effect at the beginning of this year. And we're joined now by Bruce Kramer, a lawyer representing the ACLU, in issues that we've just been talking about, voter ID laws, requirements. Thanks for joining us, Bruce.
Thank you for having me.
You have said, the ACLU has said, ACLU of Tennessee to be correct, that you are gearing up to likely file a lawsuit soon. Why don't you tell us where you are and what that lawsuit would entail?
We have been authorized by our board to challenge the decision by the state and the local election commission not to honor the issuance of the voter IDs, photo IDs by the library. And we're doing our legal research, but what we need now are actual voters who do not meet the requirements, who do not have a Tennessee driver's license, who want to vote, who have voted in the past, and for any number of reasons do not have the requirements to obtain a photo ID issued by the Department of Motor Vehicles or one of the other agencies. Primarily, that means people who don't have a birth certificate. That means some of the elderly who are born in the rural areas and there is no record of their birth. It means people who may have been married and have not changed their name or have changed their name on different occasions and cannot prove who they are to get a voter ID. But specifically, let me address one of the issues that was raised in the earlier panel. If the issue that the state wants to protect the integrity of the vote and to ensure that the person who appears at the polling station is a registered voter and is in fact the person that they state they are, then any photo ID should do that. But the legislature in its wisdom has excluded photo IDs issued by the University of Memphis or the University of Tennessee or any other accredited university.
Why do you think they did that?
You'll have to ask them that. I have my own opinions as to why they did
that. Well, what's your opinion on it?
Well, I'm not really getting into the issues of the motives on this. I think any intelligent person out there, and I think Jackson has alluded to this, and I know Bill has, you know, there's definitely going to be a disparate impact on the voting eligibility. The elderly, the indigent, the disabled, who have a difficulty getting to a place like the voter, the driver's license bureau. I think what the city did is not only legally and factually correct, but encourages people to vote. I mean, the whole idea in our democracy, and voting is a fundamental right. The Supreme Court and every state who has looked at this has said that. And the city has made it easier to get a photo ID.
But isn't the argument partly that, you know, it's too easy? I mean, you need that birth certificate. You need, I mean, this is what the opponents would say, well, that you don't want it to be too easy because this is, you're going to have voter fraud if just anyone can show up with any old ID.
Well, first of all, incidents of voter fraud at the polling booth, face-on-face it's known as, is minuscule. That's not where the voting fraud takes place. Okay? So the issue is to identify that the person who appears at the polling booth is in fact the person who's registered, and they want to have a photo ID.
Right.
Now, the state has said, let me just look at what the state says is evidence of that. A Tennessee driver license, and as I don't know who said, it could be expired. Okay, the purpose, as the chairman of the Republican Party said, is to identify the person. Well, any photo ID identifies that. If Jackson comes up with a photo that was issued by the University of Memphis that he was a student, well, it shows that he is who he purports to be.
Right.
But the state specifically excludes identification card issued to a student by an institution of higher education containing a photo of a student shall not be evidence of identification for purpose of voting. Now, if that's not evidence of who you are, why are they excluded?
All right. Let's get Jackson question.
Yeah, I want to pinpoint this idea of disproportion, which it seems to me plays into this. How many cases, certifiable cases, are you aware of voter fraud committed in relation to IDs, as against how many people have had to scramble to get photo IDs this year in Tennessee? What is the ratio?
I am unaware of any false impersonation to vote. Okay. I don't know of any reported instance of that.
So it's zero to what?
Well, the disparate impact of people who will be disenfranchised has run into the tens of thousands.
All right, and we're running out of time. Let me ask a couple quick technical questions. This lawsuit would be filed locally, state court, federal court. What's that process, or is that clear yet?
It's not clear yet.
Okay.
Whether it's going to be filed in Memphis, whether it's going to be filed in Nashville, whether it's going to be filed in state court or federal court. Those are decisions we'll make right. once we identify plaintiffs. We need plaintiffs. We need people who are impacted negatively by this, people who cannot okay. get to the motor vehicle department okay. or don't have birth certificates and don't have driver's license.
Very quick question for you, Bill.
It seems as if this is a two-pronged challenge. One is a challenge of the overall state law. Is the other part of this a challenge to include the photo library card within the state
You're absolutely right. There are two parts to this. A constitutional challenge to the photo ID law itself, and then secondly, there's a challenge to if the law stays on the books and is valid, then we think that the photo ID card issued by the library is a photo ID that meets the state statute because it is a state entity.
Okay. And are you doing this in conjunction? I think I read something, maybe a Bill's article, in conjunction with the city. I mean, the city, A.C. Wharton, the mayor, others have made noises about being upset by this. Is this in conjunction with city officials?
We are coordinating with the city in this regard.
Okay. And you would expect this to come, I mean, the November election, if you're going to get this done, you're trying to get something in place before the November election?
We would like to get something in place as soon as possible. It's a question of getting people who are plaintiffs who All right. meet the requirements.
All right. Well, thank you for being here, Bruce Kramer. Thank you to our other panelists. Thanks for joining us. Join us again next week. Good night.